We're going to cover three things. We're going to cover these here that, and I know we went over before, maybe sometimes past. But in your Bible, I'd like for you to turn your Bible to Romans chapter 5 in verse 11. And we're going to talk here of Christ anointing the mercy seat. We'll do that if I'm going to take that first. Wait a minute, I may back up here. Let me see here just a second here. Just a second here, we'll do that. Yeah, I think we'll do that. Okay, let's go here to Romans chapter 5 in verse 11, all right? Romans chapter 5 verse 11 says this. It says, "And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement." Let me just bring this out because it's a doctrinal statement. The word atonement does not belong in the New Testament. The word atonement means a covering, and it is an Old Testament word, because the blood was a covering over the mercy seat. When God looked down and seen the broken law in the Ark of the Covenant there, the blood was on the mercy seat applied by the high priest. God looked down and made an atonement because that blood pointed to the time when Christ would die upon the cross and shed his own innocent blood. Now, another word in this verse is translated from the Greek word, which means exchange or reconciliation. It is properly translated in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 and 19. And also, we find out this, that the word atonement should have been translated reconciliation. And you, if you have a Schofield Bible, you will have that note. That note should be in your Bible. We are reconciled to God. How are we doing that? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, "For he hath made him, Christ, to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." So it's reconciling us to God. Now, we find out as we go on down, in the animal blood in the Old Testament was applied to the holy place within the temple or the tabernacle, and it covered the sins of the people. That's the reason atonement means covering, not taking away sin. It covered it. And that's why in the Old Testament, no one ever went to heaven. You'll find out that the place they went, the Old Testament word is Sheol. It's the same thing as hell translated in the New Testament from the Greek word Hades, H-A-D-E-S. It had two compartments. It had paradise on one side. It had a tremendous big gulf on the other side. And then it had torment on this side. So they came to the words that it was a place of torment on one side. They translated it as hell because it's speaking about the lost people going there. But also on the other side is speaking about where every person who was saved went into the center of the earth in the paradise side. No one ever went to heaven until the Lord Jesus Christ went up and anointed the mercy seat with his own blood. Animal blood only covered sins. Christ's blood took away sins. So, let's go on down, and we're going to find out here in Hebrews chapter 9, in verse 22 and 23, if you want to write that down. Hebrews chapter 9, in verse 22 and 23. We'll wait a second till you get there, and then you'll see this, all right? And we're going to stay in Hebrews a little bit here, okay? Here we go. Verse 22 and 23, "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood is no remission. It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these or the animals," and so forth. Now, the earthly tabernacle was patterned after the heavenly tabernacle in heaven. That's what it was patterned after. It wasn't just made up. And we find that while you're there, go to Hebrews chapter 8, verse 4 and 5. Hebrews chapter 8, there in verse 4 and 5, all right? Wait a minute till you get over there. Hebrews chapter 8, in verse 4 and 5, which says this: "For if we were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished to God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For, see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount." So God had showed the pattern of the tabernacle in heaven and gave instructions for Moses, and you can read this in the Old Testament in the Pentateuch there, and it was patterned after that. Now, we come on down here and we find out when Christ came, then the blood was shed. And in John chapter 1 and verse 29, John recorded, he said, "Behold, I see the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins, therefore, and taketh away the sins. I see Christ, the Son of God, who taketh away sins," not cover sins, but taketh away sins. "Therefore, the Old Testament lamb sacrificed by faith would cover sin, but would never take a person to heaven." Now, let's go here and we find out, what about the all the saved people prior to Christ's ascension went to paradise? Here's the record, okay? Let's go here in chapter 9 in Hebrews, because Hebrews is a book that compares Christ to the angels, to the Old Testament law, to the Old Testament prophets, everything. He is greater than all. So we look here in chapter 9, and let's look here at verse 11 and 12, okay? Here we go. Chapter 9, verse 11 and 12. "But Christ being come, the high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands." See, the one on earth was made with hands. That is to say, not of this building. "Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us." 11. Now, his own blood he entered into the holy place. With that background, it becomes easy to comprehend the conversion between Christ and Mary after the resurrection recorded in John chapter 20. So let's go over here, if you will, to John chapter 20 in the New Testament here, okay? In the Gospels, John chapter 20. We begin to see this. Now Christ had arisen from the dead at his resurrection, and we find out there were a lot of people coming and going. But then, when Mary, we find out, when Mary came, she was sorry because, and we pick it up in verse 11, "But Mary stood without the sepulchre, weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and she looked into the sepulchre. And she seeth two angels in white, sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her," he said, "Woman, why weepest thou?" And she saith unto them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him." Then we come on down, "And when she had thus said, she turned herself back, and she saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. But Jesus said unto her," he said, "Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" And she, supposing him to be the gardener, said unto him, "Sir, if thou have borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said unto her, "Mary," and she turned herself and said unto him, "Rabboni," that is, "I recognize you are the Savior," which is to say, Master. Jesus said unto her, and at that time, probably she was just going to take a few steps and give him a big hug, because here she loved him, and her everything disappeared from her mind, all the things that she thought, because now he's resurrected. And he said, it's an interesting thing, why wouldn't he say, "Okay, Mary, good, you can hug me, I am your Savior, I came to this earth to die for you," but he said, no, you can't do that. Now, the thing is, you got to remember that we're still under the fact of the blood of the animals here that only covered sin. But we find out, neither by the blood of goats and calves and the heifer and the purifying of the to the unclean, the flesh by the blood and so forth, but with his own blood, his blood, he entered into the holy place in heaven, therefore to obtain eternal redemption for us. Now that hadn't happened yet, but it's going to happen right after his resurrection here. Mary comes and he said, touch me not, in verse 17, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, that's God, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and to your Father and to my God and your God, and so forth. He would not be contaminated with sinful flesh, with that beautiful resurrected body that was absolutely sinless. He would not be contaminated by any sinful person touching him and there and corrupting that. When he went to heaven, he would go there with no human being defying his resurrected body by their sinful flesh. So up he went, and he did that. Now that's very, very interesting. We come on and begin to find out that in Leviticus chapter 17, he uses an example. He says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood, which is true. That's our physical life. Without the blood, you're dead. So the physical life is there with the blood. It's found in the blood, so our spiritual life is found in the blood of another, the Lord Jesus Christ. Physical life in the blood we have, but it takes the sinless blood of another to give us spiritual life, and that is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now we know also from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19, that for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain manner of living, received by tradition from your fathers. Tradition, unless it is by those who are saved in the Word of God, always perverts the Word of God. Always. But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19. So, then we find in Romans chapter 5 and verse 8 and 9, God commendeth his love toward us while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. Aren't you glad that he died for us? If he didn't die for us, we're sunk. You know, but when we die, look for hell, because that's where we're going to be in a second, but not with Christ. We're passed from death unto life. Much more, being justified, now justified, declared righteous, by his blood we shall be saved from wrath through him. He gave his life to save ours. What a wonderful Savior. Now, we come on down and we find out here in another portion of Scripture, which you looked up just a few minutes ago in John chapter 14, in verses 1 to 3 here. You didn't look, you looked up verse 6, but he says in verses 1 to 3, let not your hearts be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I'm coming back. I'm coming back. Another doctrinal statement. He left, but he'll be back. He's going to come back at the rapture, and he's going to come back after the tribulation period to set the kingdom up for 1,000 years. And the great thing about the Bible is, all of our history books records history that has already been accomplished. The Bible tells and records history before it ever comes to pass. That's amazing, isn't it? Aren't you glad? Better put your trust, middle verse of the Bible in Psalms 118:8. Better to put your trust in the Lord than confidence in men. Really. Every tradition, the young man that I spoke to that was down and did the plumbing work and so forth, and very nice young man, very, very, very good plumber. And when I said about going to heaven, he said, well, I've let Jesus come into my heart. A satanic doctrine. Why is it a satanic doctrine? Because you didn't tell me what Christ did. You said what you did. And what you said you did couldn't come to pass because Jesus doesn't come into your heart. Ephesians 1:13, after we have heard the word and we believe, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. You never have to pray to get the Holy Spirit. You never have to ask God to get the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is promised to every believer when they trust Christ as their Savior. So all this phony baloney, oh, pray to God, give me the Holy Spirit, give me the filling of the Holy Spirit, and that. You find you're sealed by the Holy Spirit shows absolute possession. You are sealed. It will not be opened until you get to heaven there. So you can't lose your salvation. And I said to him this. I said, you know what? I said, do you know what that means? And, yes, I asked Christ to come in. I said, it means that phrase is a satanic phrase that incorporates lordship salvation, because it says, first of all, you're going to do something to let Jesus come in, which literally means, if you want to make it very simple, that you're allowing Jesus to control your life from now on. Is that salvation? No, that's not salvation. No. Before Jesus can control your life, you have to have him as your Savior. Am I right? You only have him as your Savior by not opening yourself and allowing him to come in. Whatever happened to believe? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. If you have Christ, you have eternal life. If you have not the Son, you have not eternal life, but the wrath of God abideth upon you. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you, you know, the gospel, how that Christ died, he was buried, and he rose again. And he appeared unto this many after his resurrection and so forth. The whole thing is, Christ did it all. It's finished. And wherever you pick up this phrase, and he said, well, he said, you know, my boss says that, and the pastor says that, and this and that. And I said, well, I'll tell you. And he said to me, he said, you know, I've tried to lead people to the Lord, and I'm not having any luck. I said, you're not giving them the gospel. You're giving them a way to serve the Lord without being saved. That's exactly what it is. You're going to serve Jesus. And I said, when you feel good because you let Jesus come into your heart, then you're trusting serving him by feeling good. The Holy Spirit didn't even, or the Christ never even came in. It's not there. And that's very, very deceiving, sir. You're only saved not when you invite Christ to come in. You're saved when you believe what Christ did when he did come down here and die on the cross and so forth. Man alive, did that open some things. So anyway, we went downstairs and gave him some information and so forth, and had a very good rapport with him. Very good. Anything Satan can do to use terminology to get you to trust something you do. See, I let Jesus come into my heart. How do you let him come in? Where's that at? How do you know he come in? Because I feel different. Really? You do, because now you're serving Jesus. But when did you get saved, sir? This didn't save you. Serving Jesus doesn't save you. You can have how many water baptism? Believe that, well, I'm saved now and I'm going to church, I'm a better person and so forth. Are they saved? No, they're not saved at all. It's a counterfeit of it. And since that verse is found nowhere in the Bible, he's still going to be looking for it. He's going to get back with me. He said, well, if you say it's not there, it's not there. I believe you. I said, I don't want you to believe me. I want you to hunt for it. Hunt for it. Because your church is going to ask you, oh, there's a cult religion. They don't believe in letting Jesus come into your heart and so forth. I said, we've already got accused of that by that Christian Missionary Alliance Church in Tracy. We've already got accused of that and so forth. So I said, but you do it so you search yourself and let them tell you you're a cult, because they're the ones that taught it to you. I said, you go there to the preacher and do that. He's going to do that. And that's going to be interesting. When he gets back, I'll let you know what he says. Okay. But anyway, we find out here, many times concerning this here, I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. Many Baptist preachers, many Pentecostal preachers, many Church of God preachers, many Assemblies of God preachers preach that message and interpret it this way. Look, I'm going to spoil a lot of good sermons, I suppose. But look, Christ has been in heaven for 2,000 years preparing heaven for us. It must be a beautiful place. And boy, we're all thrilled that he's been preparing this heaven for us. But let's read the verse again. Okay? Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. They're already there. So how in the world, if it were not so, I would have told you. But now I go to prepare a place for you. How did he go to prepare a place for us? He took his own blood. He said, touch me not, Mary. I have not yet ascended unto my Father and your Father, neither with the blood of bulls and goats and calves and so forth, but with his own blood he entered into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Do you see the difference? Just not taking what God says is so simple. In my Father's house are, not they're going to be, they are. They're already there. He's not preparing a second Jerusalem. Good night, he had that written, already prepared. And all the glories of heaven, and all the creation of the angels, the cherubims, the seraphims, everything is there. Heaven is already prepared. Sorry, folks, on a bad sermon there. But he's not preparing anything, they're already there, okay? Now, with that in mind, knowing that if this earthly house of our tabernacle, in 2 Corinthians 5:1, and this is a good verse to use on, Jehovah's Witnesses, because they do not believe that you go to heaven. They don't believe that at all. Show them this verse. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1, For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle, that's our bodies, were dissolved, died, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. So you go to heaven. That's where our home is, in heaven. And then we can say, we are confident and willing, rather, to be absent from the body and present with the Lord. Where's the Lord at? In heaven. Yeah. He left. In Acts chapter 1, verse 11, he said, you men of Galilee, or the angels there, you men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you, so shall come in like manner as you have seen him go. So shall we ever be with the Lord? Wherefore, comfort one another with these. And the last two verses here at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17 and 18. You see. Now, another thing here, the chart here in his ascension of Christ and paradise to heaven, which we have discovered and so forth there. Now, also, when he went up there and anointed the mercy seat and so forth, I want to bring out something else here, if I can, because this is going to be a lesson for Christians. If you'll go with me in your Bibles, and let's go over here to Acts chapter 1, all right? Acts chapter 1. Now we know in the book of Acts that we know that Dr. Luke wrote Acts, and he also wrote the epistle of Luke. He says in Acts chapter 1, he says, the former trustees, now that is the gospel of Luke. And you'll find the same thing over there, Luke chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. Have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach? He was with Christ a lot in those 3 years that he had his ministry upon the earth here. Then we come on until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles. And that's very interesting, because he gave them instructions of what to do after he ascended back to heaven. Now, those instructions are very interesting, because Peter should have known to listen to what God had told him, and he did just the opposite. Poor old Peter. Oh, I'll never deny you, Lord. And the Lord said, before the cock crows, you'll deny me 3 times. That was great. We come over here and we find out God gave him a chance 3 times in order to correct that, what he did. But we're not going to get that far. We want to get what Peter did after the resurrection. And I guess he learned his lesson because he wrote the two epistles, 1 Peter and 2 Peter. But it took a pretty good part of his life getting straightened out here and quit reasoning things out and start believing the Bible here, Peter. So let's go on down. This is going to be sort of interesting. He says here in verse 2, until the day in which he was taken up, that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also, we find out, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them for 40 days. Now, I want to stop here, and I think I've got enough time to do this real fast, okay? Let's go over here to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27, because this is the only place over here where these scriptures record this event here, okay? In Matthew chapter 27, we find out, very interesting, just two verses, okay? Matthew chapter 27 and verse 52 and 53. Now he said with many proofs here, infallible proofs means they can't be denied. It's infallible to do it. I mean, here it is right in front of your face. So we get over here and we find out in verse 52, and the graves were opened. Well, look at verse 51, and behold, the veil of the temple was rent. This is after, right after Christ. Verse 50, Jesus, when he had cried aloud, again, with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept or died, and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, that's Jerusalem, and appeared unto many. I bet they about died. They could have been at their funeral. And oh, we're here, and whatever it is, you know, you do a funeral, you know, you either try to pray them into heaven or lie about them being there, one of the two, and sometimes you tell the truth if you're in a Bible-teaching church because you led them to the Lord. You know they're saved. But here, these, many of them, many bodies of the saints, so after Christ arose, he resurrected them, many of them, because they were going to be a testimony. They didn't resurrect all of them because he emptied paradise out and took them when he ascended up into heaven there, but that didn't happen until 40 days later when he left. Now, right after his resurrection, here are all these. They've been to the funeral. They knew these men, and many of them did. Maybe it could have been their relatives. And here they are, walking around in Jerusalem, all over the place. Man, how would you like? You've been to funerals, right? Okay, what if you go up to Marshall, you run into one of them? I'll say, I'll never go to Marshall again. I'll tell you what, that'd do it for me right there. But this is with many infallible proofs. How can you, if you've been to the funeral, you've heard of these men, some of them could have been your relatives, and now they're walking around in Jerusalem in the resurrected body, looking just like they were on earth. So if you're wondering if you are going to have a body that's going to change anything about you, I think you have probably the body that you were in your 30s or something. Even at the Mount of Transfiguration, Moses and Elijah been dead for hundreds of years, and they were identified as Moses and Elijah, right? Well, sure. There's no transcendental reincarnation and all that kind of garbage. It's satanic. But anyway, here they are, and they're in Jerusalem. That's a pretty good proof. If he was at their funeral, and sometime later, you're seeing them walk around in Jerusalem, man, that's pretty much proof of the resurrection, isn't it? And not only that, but while you're here, let's go, just hold your place in Acts, because I want to get right back there. Go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Will you do that? 1 Corinthians here in chapter 15. And not only that, because it tells a few other things that Christ did in them 40 days, okay? In chapter 15, moreover, brethren, chapter 15 in verse 1 in 1 Corinthians. Boy, I'm glad we have the Bible, because it sure makes a lot of people liars, doesn't it?
Yep.
Huh? And it tells the truth to those who want it, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And thank God you want it. Isn't that great?
Right.
To know the truth. How many of you like somebody to lie to you? I hate to say this, but preachers are some of the best. Okay, here we go. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. Now, that doesn't mean you lose your salvation. By which also you're saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you. I don't know how many people down through 42 years, I'm not saying there are hundreds and thousands, but you'll find a person that will call us and say, you know, I was saved, but I'll tell you what, I begin to doubt my salvation. Okay, you doubt your salvation, you know why? You haven't been in church, a good Bible teaching church, you haven't been reading your Bible, you haven't been having fellowship with other Christians, and Satan loves you because he can never take away your salvation. He can make you doubt it. You're not going to enjoy what Christ did for you because you don't know now whether you're going to heaven or hell here since you're not serving the Lord. Well, you never lose your salvation, but you rob yourself of the blessings. So, he's saying here, you believed in vain, not that you're not saved, because these were saved in Corinthians. But I've said to just about everyone that I've ever talked to that said, and we've got several of them since we've been here in Walnut Grove, not from Walnut Grove, but from different parts of the country, of the United States and so forth. Have you been going to church? No, I don't have a good church in my area and so forth. Have you been reading your Bible? Well, no. Who are your friends now? And not Christian friends, because you're not in a church there where you can have fellowship and so forth. Satan wants you to doubt your salvation, because if you doubt your salvation, you're not going to lead anybody else to Christ because you don't have anything to give them. And yet you are saved because you can never lose your salvation. He gives you everlasting life, not everlasting life till you now believe not, but it's your fault you believe not, because you need to start reading your Bible so you'll keep on believing here and be sound in the faith. And he did that. Okay, let's go on down. For I declared unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. According to the Scriptures, said he had to rise the third day because his body would not be corrupt. When it talks about Lazarus and him dying and so forth, then Mary said, well, he's been in the grave 4 days, he begins to stinketh. Well, putrefaction sets in on the fourth day. Christ would be in the grave 3 days and three nights, and he would be out of the grave before putrefaction begins to set into the body. So, he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, that it was seen of it, and that he was seen of Cephas, as Peter, Jesus named him in John 1:42, then of the 12. And after that, he was seen of above, or over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some have fallen asleep, but the greater part until then. Now, when you get there, Corinthians is written in about 57 AD, 33, 43, 53, 7, what is that, 24 years? 53, now wait a minute. 33 years old, there, he'd been 3 years on the earth and so forth, 43, 53, 63, 57 from 63 is 6. Right. So it's been 26 years after Christ was crucified, many of these were still alive. Many of them were alive and seen him. Isn't that something? And then, we have another thing here. He said, the greater part remains unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen of James, and then of all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen of me. No Pentecostal preacher has ever seen. I love these phony, baloney preachers that say, Christ appeared to me last night. Really? What did he look like? The only description we have of Christ is his feet were as brass and his hair was white. That's the only description you have of him. That's interesting, isn't it? One's in the Old Testament, one's in the book of Revelation. Now, sir, I don't know who you've seen, but it was the devil incarnated. That's who you've seen. Sometime we have on another thing about the deceivableness of Satan and so forth. We'll take you to Eliphaz in the book of Job and show you his dream was satanic, and he gave it to Job as it was from God. Very slick. But we're not going to pursue that now, because I want to get to one other thing. But anyway, last of all, he was seen to me. Nobody has ever seen the Lord Jesus Christ since the Apostle Paul. Now, let's go back here to the book of Acts, and I want to cover this. I can do this here pretty fast here, okay? You come over here now, seen of many infallible proofs, those were just a part of it, and fulfills that. And then in verse 4, being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait. And I would underline that wait in my Bible. When he said wait, he meant wait. It was to wait for the promise of the Father, that is the Holy Spirit, which saith he, ye have heard of me. Now John truly baptized with water, you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence. Right down in reference to verse 5, you're baptized with the Holy Ghost, or the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12:13. 1 Corinthians 12:13, where it is spiritual baptism. It's not water baptism, okay? Now, we come and find out there that in verses 9 and verse 5, I should say, he met with them. They were to wait in Jerusalem 10 days until Pentecost and the giving of the Holy Spirit. And that is in verse 5 where it says that, wait for the Holy Spirit. Then we come, and you read these, we come on down here to, and then in verses 4 to 8, let's go on down here. He said here then, in verse 6, and when they were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? No, and he said unto them, it's not for you to know the times and the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me both in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. It would be like Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and then the rest of the world, and so forth, and there. But then we come on down, and we find out that in verses 9 to 11, Christ departed, emptied paradise of the saved, and took them to heaven. Okay, but I want to go on down to verse 12 now, okay? Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olive, which is from Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey, about a half a mile or so of there. Now, let's go on down to verse 13. What happened then? He told them to wait. And when they were come, they went into the upper room where abode both Peter, James, John, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, Zelotes, and Judas, the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with the brethren. Now, here we come on down to verse 15. Peter did not wait, as Christ has said. When you get the Holy Spirit with power, you also get instructions, because he is, John says, when he comes, he will teach you all things. Now, verse 15, in those days, here we go, Peter, you never learn. I can't believe this. Peter, what does Peter say? In those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples, and he said, the number of names together were about 120. Now, men and brethren, this scripture needs to be fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas. Judas died. Remember, he went out and hung himself there? Yeah. And which was guide to them that took Jesus. Now, for he was numbered with us and had obtained part of the ministry. He was an apostle. Now, this man purchased the field with the reward of iniquity, falling headlong. He burst under in the midst and his bowels gushed out. It was known, and it was known unto all dwellers of Jerusalem, inasmuch as the field is called, and so forth, the proper tongue of Salama, and that is to say, the field of blood. Now, this is very interesting. For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, and no man dwell therein. For his bishopric, that is his office, bishopric, let another take. So now Peter's going to lead them all, and we're going to appoint two, and we're going to vote on it, and it'll be God's will that this will take place. But what did God tell Peter?
Wait.
Now, that's very interesting. He said, wait. Hold your place. Go back to Isaiah chapter 40, okay? And look at the last verse. Isaiah chapter 40. This is a good lesson for all Christians in 31, okay? Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31. There we go. Are we there?
No.
Still got the pages turning. Isaiah
1.
Okay, here we go. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. That is, there are times when God tells a Christian to wait. Don't get mad over somebody who's done something. You're going to tell them off. Hold your... Control yourself. That's just one thing. Or you may get mad at the preacher, I want to be in church. Just wait. We had one lady left our church. You know why she left our church? Because she wanted her brother to run the tape back here. Well, her brother has earrings on. Her brother was never dressed appropriately to be put in front of anybody in the congregation. And then she wanted her daughter to sing, which she used to do. But she was shacked up with another man and been living with him, and then called me on the phone and said, I want to start serving the Lord and I want to start singing. I said, you can't sing when you're living in adultery. Well, that made this lady just furious, because anything, it didn't matter what kind of lifestyle her children had. Just put them up in front of the church, get them in front of the church. I said, I'll tell you what, you go to your mother, see if you can live with her. And this is what other ladies do. Get yourself an apartment, support yourself like other ladies do. Some of them do it when they have two children, if you got divorced and everything else. And here you are, you're living in adultery, and I can't put you up there. What have you got to give God the glory when you're living in adultery? Get away from this man. Either that or get married. And you want to serve the Lord while you're living in adultery? The answer is no. Well, I've never seen her again. She's never been back to church. I said, it'd be better for you, first of all, to live the life, get out of the adulterous situation, and then I'd be glad to let you sing. But you're just making a fool out of yourself if I put you up here. You've got nothing to give people when they know you're living in adultery, and you get up here singing, I love Jesus. Never seen her again. Her mother left the church, her father left the church, and been one of our worst enemies ever since. But this is the kind of thing that she wanted to do. Just get my children up there. No values at all as far as Christian living, except the phoniness that she puts on to present to everybody else. These are the things pastors have to deal with, some of you don't know anything about. So, let's go on down here, all right? Wait upon the Lord, shall renew their strength, okay? God told you, Christ told you, he said, Peter, you're to wait in Jerusalem. Don't do a thing until the Holy Spirit comes, and it will indwell you with power. And with power comes also instructions, and it comes with wisdom, and it comes with understanding, because that is the teaching of the Holy Spirit and his responsibility. Now we go on down. We find out on down here that instead of this, now I'd like for you to read down here in verse 23, and they appointed two, Joseph called Barsabas, who was surnamed Justus, and another man by the name of Matthias, or you might say Matthias. Okay, so we come over here and find out what took place. Okay, and they prayed, oh my, dear Lord, dear Heavenly Father, give us wisdom here to choose the right one. But you already went against what God told you, so you can pray all you want. Why are you praying instead of obeying? You're to obey. Peter, shut your mouth. Quit influencing the others. Sit down and shut up. Will you do that for 10 days? I'm going to ascend back to heaven. You only got to wait 10 days. And then I will give you and send the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost when the church started. Now notice what it says. And they prayed and said, Thou, Lord, which knowest the hearts of all men. Yep, he knows yours too, Peter. Show whether of these two thou hast chosen. Well, isn't that something? That he may take part of this ministry and apostleship from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles, all out of the will of the flesh, nothing spiritual, and going against the instructions the Lord said, you were to wait at Jerusalem, do nothing there. It's an amazing thing. Now we'll show you something, and then we'll bring this right to a conclusion, okay? Matthias is never mentioned again anywhere in the Bible because he's rejected God. You did all this out of the flesh, Peter. Now, I want to show you something. What was God's choice? I'd like for you to go with me now over here to Romans chapter 1. Will you do that? Romans chapter 1. Okay? We'll find out who God had in mind to be the apostle who replaced Judas. Romans chapter 1. And then we're just going to keep going in the right here, and then we'll stop. Okay? Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle. That's why he put it when he wrote, because many didn't accept his apostleship, and Christ had made him the apostle who replaced Judas. I'd like for you to go on over here now, if you will, to 1 Corinthians. Just keep turning right in your Bible. You don't have to hunt for it. It's the next one in line. And we come over here to 1 Corinthians, okay? 1 Corinthians, we come to chapter 1, verse 1. Paul called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God. I'd like for you to go to 2 Corinthians. Will you come over to 2 Corinthians? This is how important that God had the Holy Spirit put this in here to show you it's better to put your trust in the Lord than confidence in men. Peter, you should have went over there in Jerusalem and sit down and shut up and did exactly what God said. Now he has to put this everywhere in the Bible to show that you were wrong, you know? So we come to 2 Peter. I'd like for you to notice in chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. Okay. Let's go on over again, because next we come to Galatians. Let's go here to the book of Galatians. Do you ever wonder why this starts out like this? Now you'll know. In the book of Galatians, here we go. Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God, the Father who raised him from the dead. Sorry, Peter. You should have. You bloobered more, but you finally came around and wrote 1st and 2nd Peter and did a wonderful job. Okay, Galatians here. Now we go over here to another here in Ephesians. We got the book of Ephesians coming up. Ephesians chapter 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. That's very simple, isn't it? Well, let's keep going right in our Bible here, because we need quite a few here. But just to go to show you, God's going to say, my will is going to be made known, not yours. Okay. So we come over here then, and we come to the book of Colossians. We pass Philippians, we come to Colossians. Colossians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. Oh, we got it again. Okay, what about that? Let's go over here to 1 Timothy. He's writing to young Timothy now. So let's go to 1 Timothy. Just keep turning right in your Bible. You get 1 Timothy. You got that? Okay, just right. Now we go to verse 1 again. Chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God, our Savior, and the Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope. They said, man, God says that, Christ says that. He is the apostle. Okay, let's go to 2 Timothy. Now he's not only fully Timothy that once, he's going to tell him again. 2 Timothy, second letter. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, according to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. Well, pretty good. So, in this, and also the next one here, which is Titus, look at that, chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and according, allegedly, of the truth, which is after godliness, and so forth. I'm going to ask you a question now. Who is the apostle that God wanted to replace Judas, who was an imposter? Who was it?
Paul.
Paul, the Apostle Paul. You got that. How important it is when God tells us something. Have you ever run ahead of the Lord and you just like tell somebody off? Now, this is just a simple illustration. There are many, many illustrations. Yeah. Don't you sometimes wish you had waited? Sometimes somebody will try to, if they're not going to church, they don't want you to go to church. Makes them feel bad. Makes them have a guilty conscience and so forth. Did it ever dawn on you to say no when you're enticed to do something that God doesn't want you to do? Did it ever dawn on you to say no, no? If I know God wants me to do something, then do it. Don't lay it aside. If He doesn't want me to do something, then I need to wait and turn it over to the Lord and let Him handle it. He can do a better job and may not want to handle it the way I would. Sometimes you like to place the glory of the Lord on their nose. That's not really, I've never had a permission to do that. But boy, sometimes when people go against you and or lie about you or something, you feel like, boy, I just like to give them a bloody nose. You know, or something. That's not a very good illustration, but has your old nature ever enticed you to do something you knew really you shouldn't do? Well, maybe we've all had it to some degree or some way. But the lesson is, Peter, God's going to use you greatly, but He's got to get you settled down first. He's got to get you to listen very simply, Peter. I told you to go to Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Holy Spirit, which would have been in 10 days. I'm going to ascend back into heaven. I hope I can trust you. He couldn't. Nope, he screwed it all up. They get together and they're spiritual. And they prayed. Oh, dear Lord, give us the right man. We're going to give you two choices now. You know, boy, I just about bust out loud. Why didn't you get five choices? You know, why didn't you do that? Why didn't you throw the Apostle Paul in there and you'd have been on a pretty safe ground, you know? But whatever. But anyway, it's just a wonderful thing to know this. And one thing in closing, go to Romans 8:11, and we'll close right there. That's it. Romans 8:11, because the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the down payment showing that you and the same Spirit that raised up Christ, you have in your body the Holy Spirit. Notice in verse 11, but if the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He hath raised up Christ from the dead, he that hath raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that dwelleth in you. Mortal bodies are those that are alive. Alive. That's the mortal bodies. I thank God if the Lord sounds that trumpet in a moment, the twinkling of an eye. I thank you, dear Holy Spirit in me and every one of you that have trusted Jesus Christ, and that every one of you have. You know what? I'm going up with a brand new body.
Yep.
Isn't that something? I've tried to get the Lord to give it to me ahead of time. No such luck. I can't do it. But I thank the Lord. When it comes time, I'll have it. I just like trade it in now and give me a few more years, you know. But, you know, we do the best we can. Okay, so much for that. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Thank you. Before you do, let me just illustrate this real fast because there are others that are going to get things and see it. If you don't know you're going to heaven when you die, then truthfully, it's your fault. It's in the Bible. This represents sin. God says, Max Schaus, don't go to hell and pay for your sins. Please don't go to hell. You don't have to do a thing. Don't ask me to save you. Don't ask me to come into your heart. Just believe what I told you I did for you, and I'll give you eternal life. I died for you. The sand represents Christ. I came from heaven to earth. I took on a human body sinless. I went to the hell of the cross. So you don't have to go to the lake of fire, which is a hell, up a place to go. That's called hell. I don't want you to go there. I'm not willing you to perish. I put it in the Bible, so anybody that disagrees with the Bible, don't pay attention to them. Because they're a minister of Satan trying to get you off of the track by tradition and all kind of stuff. I love the world. I gave my only begotten Son. And if you'll believe that, All you've got to do is believe it. Hey, my only begotten Son, whosoever believeth in Him, I believe in Him that He went to the cross, He paid for my sins, I don't have to go to hell. And all I have to do is believe it, trust it, have faith in it. All synonymous words. I'm not trusting anything. I not have one doubt. You did that for me, and I'm eternally grateful. I promise you, you will never perish, Max Jones, but have everlasting life. And I'll take your sin and mark it paid completely. We make a trade. I take your sin, nail it to the cross, and I will give you what you could never have yourself, my righteousness. I'm going to give it to you. Boom! So now you're fit for heaven. When you leave this earth and leave this body, which can never go to heaven, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, because the sinful body, I'll give you a brand new body. It'll never be sickness, sorrow, or death again. The last enemy destroyed will be death. And you and I are going to live together for all eternity. And I got a lot of great things in the future ahead that you don't know anything about. What a wonderful time when we meet Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful to you. We thank you so much. If you're listening, you've never trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray that you'll do that, because you're the only one that can send yourself to God. And be because your unbelief, your skepticism, and so forth like that, listening to idiots that don't know anything, and there, if you just listen to the Lord, He loved you, He gave His Son for you, paid for your sins, you go to hell with your sins paid for, please don't do that. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved from hell. Bless each one in Jesus' precious name. Amen.